Listener discretion is advised. Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
Loveline, coast to coast.
Hey, Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Dr. Drew, board certified physician, addiction medicine specialist. Yeah. That's right, Anderson. I'm the man. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Hey, Drew, you know what I'm this close to doing, buddy?
Couldn't be dropping trout.
Trout. Hell yeah. This close to dropping trout, everybody. Woo! Oh, man. I'll tell you, Drew. You know the other thing I like when they do on morning shows? Like, one guy starts talking and the other guy talks about how crazy he is. Oh, man. Don't say it. Oh, you're a madman. Oh, man. You're going to get us thrown off the air. You're out of control, brother.
Hold me back.
Oh, man. I'll tell you, Drew, you are loose cannon, man. We're going to march right up the hall and right into the program director's office, man. You're going to chew us a new A-hole. And you know what I'll have to do so we can get to my A-hole? Drop trout. Yeah, I don't think I won't either. Woo! We got a big show coming up for you tonight. We got nobody. Yeah. We got a bunch of stone 15-year-old callers. Yeah. Don't worry. Dr. Drew's going to find out where they were molested. Woo-hoo-hoo. See if their dad made them drop trout when they were younger. Tell you what now. Yeah, girls are going to cry. That's right. Adam's going to make the same jokes like dropping trout.
That's the show. There you go.
What? There you go. Hold on. All that, I took up a minute and 42 seconds. That's it?
That's the show.
Jesus Christ. What are we going to do? I'll tell you, I ran a red light about 3 weeks ago in my car. And out here in L.A., we got the cameras at the intersections, you know?
They're these automated devices that catch you in the act.
Mm-hmm. Two flashes. I don't know what the two flashes are for. Maybe the one... It's not front and back. No.
They don't want to see your pupil, the red light, come back through your pupils.
I hope it's not front and back. It's just front and front. It's like one means, you passed it. You triggered it, and the next one's a picture. I'm not exactly sure. If someone knows what the two flashes are, tell me. I saw two, but not front and back, front and front. Huh. And this, by the way, is why I don't wear a front license plate. Oh, yes.
Oh, you're wild, man.
Yeah. You want to know why?
You're dangerous.
Because I don't get the tickets. Huh. See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Maybe I shouldn't be talking about this, but...
You can get a ticket for that, though.
You can get a ticket from that, but that's $25, and that's just a fix-it ticket. That's not a $250.
Oh, is that what
doesn't go on your record either.
Running red light is $250.
Sorry about that, but yeah, it's like $200 and change, and it goes on your record.
Wow!
But you don't have that front license plate, they don't know who you are. So that's the good news.
Good times.
Oh yeah, I'm like a modern day Jesse James, except for instead of a horse, I use a mule. You thought I was gonna say car, right?
Car without a front plate. Yeah.
Yeah.
And let's hop back on the phones, Drew, and speak to Sid. Sid is 18. He's got that fetish for guys getting kicked in the nuts.
Yep.
Sid?
Yep.
Yeah.
When did you first discover this, and how?
Well, he was riding his bike.
Ah.
No, I guess for as long as I remember, like, I can remember being 5 and trying to coax one of my friends into doing it.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
But now, is that a sexual fetish, or is that just something that's good for a laugh?
I would say sexual. Sexual,
all right,
yeah.
Listen, he's full of crap.
Yeah.
No, I'm serious. I'm not. Hello?
What happened? What did he do, hang up?
Yeah, it seemed like it.
All right. He was starting to run into that Adam Sandler voice. That's why I didn't believe him.
Yes. Leon?
Yeah.
Leon, you're 30. What's up?
Hey, yeah. How you guys doing?
Good.
Good.
I'm calling from San Diego, and of course, the big news down here has been the shooting. And I got to thinking about it, and I got to think about how you guys are always saying, like, how bad parenting leads to bad kids.
Oh, yes.
I was wondering if you thought that maybe it would be a good idea if, like, for every crime that's committed by a teenager or a kid, the parents should also be held just as accountable. Like what
we've,
I mean,
we've said that it's something like that for years.
Fine or a penalty is imposed on that minor, then the same penalty should be imposed on the parent.
Yeah. Well, Leon.
Yeah.
I think we know how you feel about it. We feel the same way. We absolutely do. I liken your child to a dog. You own a dog. You let that dog run free. That dog bites somebody. You're in trouble.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
It is the exact same thing.
Or at least it'd be incumbent on the parents to show that they did everything responsible to try to treat or manage this kid's behavior.
But I've seen it 1,000 times where you just see the single mother and she's got 5 kids and she's like, I can't do anything to stop this kid. He's all over the place. What am I supposed to do? And it's like, here's what you're supposed to do. Have him arrested.
Yeah, that's right.
Whatever it is, do what you would do with that dog.
That's right.
If you can't keep that goddamn dog in your yard and stop him from getting out and biting the neighbors, then you put him down.
Yeah.
Or you send him away to some camp or some farm that your uncle has. Or you call somebody. But you do something. You act like if, you know, here's what I want parents to think. If you got a 13-year-old, a 14-year-old, 15-year-old who's out of control, who's running wild, who's constantly getting into trouble, I want you to fear that the cops are going to show up and take you.
That's right. They should.
And if you have that fear, I guarantee you'll do something about that kid.
Yeah.
Because there's no way you're going to be laying around not knowing where he is, thinking the cops are going to show up for you in a few minutes. I'd love to make parents responsible for that. Hey, nature or nurture, it's their fault. Any way you want to slice it. All right, where are we at here, Drew?
Here's Desiree. She is 17.
Yeah.
Yeah. Here we go. Desiree.
Hello?
Yes. This is where you talk.
I'm sorry?
Me too.
Hang up on her.
I'm sorry too. All right, let's go to...
Lisa?
Yes.
You're 29.
I am.
Well, what's up?
Well, I'll be honest and tell you everything about me up front. My parents were divorced when I was 2. I was molested by an older child in the block when I was 5.
Perfectly normal, perfectly healthy.
Had sex with the kid that was molested at the same time when I was 8.
Perfectly normal, huh?
And alcoholism runs on both sides of my family. I'm a shopaholic as a result. I'm not into alcohol because...
Yeah.
I couldn't wear the clothes that I bought if I was in alcohol, so, but I am definitely a shopaholic. And my family is still not okay. My grandmother passed away at the beginning part of this year, and my mother has disowned me.
Why?
Because she says that my grandmother really didn't love me. My grandmother and I did have a falling out. She claimed that I took money from her, which I did not and could have proved to them. They called my bank, found out what was in my account, and I could have proved to them that I didn't take it.
Hey, Lisa, hold on. Can you please turn the damn TV set down back there?
Oh, it's my 2.5-year-old. I'm sorry. I'll switch rooms if Cow and Chicken is bothering you.
Yes, great question. What's
the curfew on the kid? 2 a.m.?
Oh, he takes after his mommy, stays up late, and we sleep in the morning, so.
Hold on a second. Let me talk to Drew. Listen, I'm no counselor at the daycare center, but 2.5-year-old up at 11-something at night watching TV, isn't that a little, isn't that wrong? Isn't she supposed to turn in, you know, when the streetlights come on? Sleeping in?
Yeah, it's going to be a problem when preschool starts.
Yeah, I thought kids just had a cycle of...
Some go late. No. Some go late.
Listen, I'll shoot my kid with a tranquilizer dart if he don't get his ass in bed by 8. That's the way I run things. All right, well, what the hell are we talking about? The Lisa? I don't know. The whole family's a mess.
She didn't ask a question.
Oh.
The question is...
Okay, so my mother claims my grandmother didn't love me. She just made amends with me. And when my grandmother passed away, my husband and I, we unfortunately did some interstate moving and were in need of some furniture. So I was asking for my grandmother's furniture. But my mom sided with my stepfather to give it to his stepdaughter, who was on welfare in Washington. They brought her down because my mother owned the duplex where my grandmother lived.
Hold on a second. Lisa?
Yes?
Hold on a second. Drew, I'm going to play some hacky sack in the corner. When she spits out the goddamn question, would you tell me?
I'm trying to explain.
No, you're not. Shopaholic.
Well, my mother disowned me. Okay.
And your mother disowned you. And what, the question is...
selfish and wanted my grandmother's things.
Fine.
She
What's your question?
And we haven't talked since then.
What's your question?
It has affected me.
Sure.
Okay. But how great a mom was she anyway?
Single mom. You know.
She didn't do much for you growing up, did she?
No, and I've tried to get on with my life, but, you know, that kind of set me back.
Okay. But you don't like her anyway.
No.
How come I'm the only one healthy enough with the screw the family attitude? I really mean it. I mean, my parents are busting their ass to be nice to me now because there were such pains in the ass when I was a kid. But, hey, if they weren't busting their ass, I'd never talk to them again. Screw them. I mean, I don't understand it. I mean, I know there's a bond. I know you should have that. And I know something happened to me. But, hey, if your parents were crappy to you growing up, you know, they hatched you, and then there were bad people, and they didn't take care of you, and they didn't look out for you, and you got molested, and you got raped, and God knows what else went on, and there's alcoholism or some abuse or neglect. Hey, screw them. I know everything's connected to them, but get past it. I mean, they're not good people, and they're now disowning their children. Hey, screw you. Mom, just move on. I mean, I know I'm just telling someone to move on from their mom, but what are you leaving? Let's look at it that way. What, good memories? Future memories? A loving grandmother? Or some lazy alcoholic bitch who chain smokes out on the porch and complains too much? Do you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Move on. I think the biggest problem with a lot of people that call the show is not so much what their folks are doing to them, but it's that they can't, what they're doing to themselves through their folks. They can't let go. Their attitude should be, listen, I did nothing. Mom disowned me for doing nothing, or at least according to her story. Ball's in her court. Move on. That's it. I know the husband's probably happy. Talking about dodging a bullet there.
Husband.
Her husband.
She have a husband?
She said she had a husband.
Huh.
Yes, she did.
All right.
You don't believe me?
No, I believe you.
All right.
Had, I think, is the appropriate word. Yeah.
Do you have a husband?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
All right.
He's glad you're not talking to your mom, right?
Well, he's called her to try to get her to talk to me.
Oh, really? Oh, boy. Now I don't trust him.
All right. Brian?
Oh, sleeping.
This guy's so lying.
Yeah, I agree with you.
My butthole's bigger than a mason jar. Thank you.
Is that it?
It would have been better if we didn't know he was full of crap. But Brian, it was too. It was the snoring was too novel.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Well, not novel, too unnatural.
I went for
yeah. It was novelty snoring. Yeah.
I'm not a fat guy. That's the problem.
I know. But see, we would have been subtly intrigued if it was just a light snore.
Just heavy breathing.
Yeah,
just heavy breathing.
Okay, hold on. Let me try again.
Try it again.
Ready. Ready.
All right, listen. Hold on. I'm going to go to you again. Okay.
Okay.
All right. Okay.
Brian.
Let's see if we can have fun with it this time. Brian, line two. Brian, you're 22.
Forget that heavy breathe. There you go.
No. Listen.
Why the over the top
listen,
stuff?
Stop,
breathe.
Stop jacking off and fake snore for us.
Just breathe. Dude, all you would have to do is.
Yeah, you know, not even that much. If you think about most our fake, not fake, if you think about most our real callers that fall asleep, and that's a good 40%. The phone is slightly, it's fallen off them a little.
Yeah.
So that's a little in the background. They're not up on it
but,
like
but,
this.
But, if, but it would intrigue us, though, if we had the right on. Oh, finally, one right on. And somebody's mouth is over the thing.
Here, I'll do one, right? And Drew, come to me.
We're going to Adam in line two. Here we go. Adam
don't use my real name.
Oh, come on, beg your pardon. We're going to Sam on line three. He's 22.
Well, I don't like Sam either. Give me a name like Jake.
Going to Bruce.
Jake.
Keith.
Toby.
Stuart.
Toby. Jake. Okay, ready?
Line three.
Okay.
And action. Yeah. Now I'm going to sleep.
Perfect.
You see, you got to break it up a little too. You can never. I don't know how the whole night. No two breaths are the same. They're like snowflakes. I don't know how that works. But everyone we call is really asleep.
Yeah.
They're breaking it up constantly.
Yeah, you're right.
They're like on a. They're dreaming that they're on a pogo stick or something. Hey, Brian.
Okay. Well, the important thing is that I just get out in the air that my butthole is bigger than Mason Jar.
Right. Right. All right, buddy.
Okay. Thanks.
All right. Good times there, buddy.
Yeah. Have a good night, guys.
All right. All right. Good times.
That guy doesn't even know the joke.
No.
He doesn't know the history of that joke, obviously.
Well, you know, kids today. It's the Love Line. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew over there. No. Cannot have. I was standing around my den last night for some reason thinking about no, cannot have. Alrighty. Somebody called, wanted to talk about The Family Guy, which is one of my favorite shows. And then he fell off the line. But I want to say this, that Seth MacFarlane, who's been on this show, who's the creator of The Family Guy, and does quite a few voices on The Family Guy, came out with us to do some...
Crank Anchors
last weekend, and was phenomenal.
Really?
Phenomenal, the voices this guy does. I'm rarely envious of other people's talent, but I sat there, green as a Kentucky pasture.
Did he do Family Guy voices, or were they?
And then I think to myself, my God, wouldn't it be marvelous if I turned out to be a homosexual?
Was it like that, or was it?
He did like the
versions of that.
He did the Rhode Island guy, but he did like this 50 salesman guy, and he did a whole bunch of different voices, and he was just just spectacular. Yeah. Then Andy Dick came over and to do voices, and he was loaded.
No.
I think so, yeah.
Uh-oh, with alcohol? Or
no, I don't know. I don't know.
Because, what made you say that? Because he was so fragmented? Or?
Yeah, yeah. We'll talk off the air, Drew, but there's trouble brewing.
Jesus Christ in heaven! Where has this been? Send me an ounce of this stuff!
Yeah, I think he got more than an ounce. He got a kilo or two. I don't know. I don't know what's going on with Andy Dick, but I think something's going on with Andy Dick.
Was he able to do the show?
Not really. Uh-uh. I think there's some little game on kind of thing going on there. He was sober for a while, right?
Quite a while. No relapse is part of the disease. So.
Yeah. Now I don't know for sure. He said he wasn't feeling well. But I think something's going on.
We should leave at this point.
We should get him in here and talk to him. Chet.
Yeah.
You're 36.
Right.
What's going on?
Well, I was coming home and I heard you bring up paranormal experiences, and I thought I'd share you one that I'd come across.
All right. Where are you from?
I'm originally from Tennessee, but this happened in Arkansas when I was in high school.
Okay. Yeah, there's something, like I said, I grew up in North Hollywood. I knew a ton of people. No one ever breathed a word of it. Never came up. No one ever saw a ghost. Nothing was haunted. Nothing.
Yeah.
Ever. It's a regional thing. It's Southern California. There's nothing in Southern California.
It must be because there were tons of... I ran across people all the time in the South who had some story.
Right.
But, you know...
All right, well, tell us your story.
Okay. I ran across this girl who told me about this. She gave me this folk story about you go out to this old road and you drive over this bridge and you look in your rearview mirror and you see this headlight, and it's the headlight of this motorcycle rider who was a hit-and-run victim.
Right.
And it sounded enticing, so I went out there with her and a couple of the guys, and it's this two-lane country highway, like 30 minutes southwest of Little Rock, Arkansas, middle of nowhere, and this little country lane is straight and pretty flat, and we just pulled right off of an interstate, and so we pull off over on the shoulder, and kill the motor, kill the lights, and not too far ahead of us, there are trees that cover this lane and kind of make kind of a tunnel, so it's like dark. And even though, I mean, of course it's night, but the trees made it even darker and made kind of this like cave effect. We sat there for maybe like 5 minutes, and out of nowhere, over the left shoulder, the opposite shoulder of the road, a little farther, just a little, I get so excited when I tell the story, where the trees began to...
Hold on, Chet, road. You are so lucky I got a big book of porn in front of me, otherwise I'd be bored as hell. I just hope all our listeners have a nice big book of porn in front of them, too. All right, so you're on the shoulder of the road.
Right. And then this light pops up on the left, the opposite shoulder. It's probably the size of, just out of nowhere, this like crimson-red light pops up. It's maybe 6 feet off the ground.
Mm-hmm.
It's about the size of a volleyball. And it's just there. And we all start freaking out. And it's hovering. It's not moving. And then it begins to change color. It lightens into an orange. Then it becomes yellow. Then it becomes white. And as it lightens in color, it expands in size. And then as it became white, stayed that way for, maybe 10, 15 seconds, and then disappeared like it was never there.
So that was the headlight of the guy who bought it on the motorcycle.
That's the folk story that goes with it.
Yeah.
So
probably some farmer who brings a piece of equipment out every night about there. That.
Right. I know. Okay, well, wait.
It's the triangle reflector on the back of the plow.
Better.
Yeah.
We pull up. We pull up. The guy starts the car. We drive into the like cave of where the trees.
Right.
And the thing pops up again, and it's much closer. It's in the middle of the road, and he turns on his lights, and we're moving along maybe 10, 15 miles an hour, and this thing is lower than the. It's like even with the top with the hood of the car, maybe a little lower. And 10, 15 feet in front of the car, and we speed up. And as we speed up, it speeds up. And it kind of stretches out, and you can see through it. And you can see the ground or the asphalt through it. But it's emitting light. It's like this. It's really bizarre. And we chased it, and he sped up trying to catch up with it, but we never caught up. The distance didn't change any. And then, again, it was gone. And then for like a year... After that, I started bringing all my friends out there.
And did you ever see it again?
Oh, yeah. We saw it. Sometimes we'd go out there, not at all. Sometimes it would put on a big show. And one time, finally, somebody had the brilliance to bring binoculars. And I had like 7 friends with me. And we were laying prone, side by side, across this street, this country highway. And there were 2 guys to the left of me and a number to the right of me. And the guys to the left of me are looking at this thing, and it's really making a huge show, and it's maybe 60, 75 yards away from us, hovering over the middle of the road.
Yeah, and what'd the guy with the binoculars see?
Well, they're going ooh-ah, ooh-ah, and I finally get it. And I looked to the bare eye, it looked like one like white ball, all right?
Yes.
I put the binoculars in my eyes, and I looked through the binoculars, and this thing is... It is a ball. It's about the size of a basketball, and it's perfectly round, and it's turning on an axis.
Yeah.
And it has like an equator line, and one side of it's white, and one side's red, and this line is diagonal.
Right. That's the cops.
No, it is as clear as looking at. I could see it sharper.
Shit.
I know it's weird.
You're giving me the heebie-jeebies now. I'm going to let you go. All I know is this. I never seen anything. Drew never seen nothing. I remember for a while this whole Devil's Triangle thing was hot. That sort of mysteriously went away. There was a time when, hey, if you took a boat through the Bermuda Triangle, 50-50 chance you'd never come back. Now everyone sails right through it, flies right over it. Nothing ever happens. It's nonsense. I remember watching, they used to have good movies of the week. They had, like, the Bermuda Triangle. And I'm going to say something, a joke I've said before, but it's more of an observation, which is the sequel to the Bermuda Triangle was called No, the secret, it was called the Devil's Triangle. That was a couple islands in Bermuda or something, and a bunch of planes went down there and all that kind of stuff. But the sequel to the Devil's Triangle movie was called Beyond the Devil's Triangle.
Right.
And I thought, hey, you idiots, I'm sitting in my living room on Beyond the Devil's Triangle. I mean, you're just in Bermuda. If you're beyond the Bermuda Triangle, aren't you? Isn't that that's kind of the plan, actually, is to
get beyond it.
Get beyond it. Yeah. And beyond, it's just, it's anywhere but in the Bermuda Triangle. But that was a good one. I don't think anyone brings that up anymore.
No.
I would be surprised if you asked the average 20-year-old about the Bermuda Triangle, they even knew what the F you're talking about.
All right, this is Chris, 20.
Yo, am I on?
Chris. Yeah.
What up, Adam? You're a god, man.
Thanks, all right. Chris.
So, this weekend, we were drinking a lot. My friend had a dart, and he threw it at...
Chris. He threw the dart at your screwball friend, didn't mean to hit him, but threw the dart right at him, sufficiently to put the dart into his arm. Of course he meant to hit him. Was he loaded or something?
Yeah, drinking a lot.
Drunken screwballs.
Yeah, all right.
All right. Lucky did him in the eye.
Yeah, it was pretty stupid. I agree.
All right.
But, so, we're like, oh, that's pretty cool. So we started doing it repeatedly. But, you know, like, we put, like, a box in front of our head, so it wouldn't hit our head, and, like, in front of our body. So we're just throwing it right into our shoulders, basically.
Right.
And so we're throwing the same dart back and forth, and I find out later that one of my friends has herpes. And I want to know if I could have gotten it that way, because it's basically like sharing a needle.
Well, it is exactly like sharing a needle. You could have hit an artery and bled to death. You could have punctured a lung easily, really easily.
Drew, you could tip back on that chair. The mic cord could get wrapped around your neck, and you could die there. There's not a goddamn thing any one of us could do or would want to do about it.
Artery in the arm is about an inch down. That's where they were just enough to hit that. That's serious.
Inch down. Yes. Give me a break. That's
why don't they just use swords?
All right. Look. You're fine. You don't now because
herpes is not herpes thing, is right? A rash, and it's a contact transmission. It's not a bloodborne. But God only knows what else you might have contracted from your buddies.
What, you, right. Like AIDS or like what else?
Like hepatitis C, AIDS. I mean, you should actually be tested.
Oh, please.
For hepatitis C, for sure.
You're fine.
Takes a few weeks for that to evolve.
I get rid of this guy. He's fine. You know what always cracks me up is the baseball game on the back of the dartboard that no one has ever played in a billion,
ever.
Zillion years.
Ever.
I've never even seen it facing out. I've never seen it even flip that way.
Yeah.
Somebody at the dartboard place had a revelation when it decided to
they just
to do
had
it.
An extra stencil or something.
You think so?
Throw it up there. Oh, yeah.
That,
Joe, we got to put something on the back of this thing.
I mean... That caught on like that was like a worse idea than the metric system and 8-track all put together.
Joe,
in beta.
It's America's favorite pastime. We'll just put it on the back of the dartboard.
And you'd think it would be better than actually just throwing it at a group of hoops that got smaller toward the center.
Steve, 19. Is that him sleeping? Steve.
Yes.
What's up?
How's it going, Adam?
Good.
I love the mantra.
Thank you, Stan.
Okay. I recently had a blood test done, just like a regular thing at my doctor's, and my liver toxin levels, there's like two indicators, I guess.
Yeah, those aren't toxin. Those are liver enzymes.
Okay, yeah. One of them was 3 times normal, and the other was like 2 times normal.
So do you drink a lot?
Well, on the weekends.
Well, there you go.
That's it?
But, the doctor said that he was shocked to see that they were so high. He said, like, if I was a 40-year-old man and they'd been boozing it for 20 years, he would understand. But, like, they're apparently really worried. He told me I shouldn't drink any liquor for 3 months. And, like, I take folic acid and stuff, too.
All right, here's the deal. Are you on any medication?
No.
Anything? Nothing over the counter? Anything like that?
No, nothing.
Well, did they check you for viral hepatitis?
I don't think so.
Okay, you absolutely need to get tested for hepatitis C and hepatitis B.
All right.
Okay. Would smoking marijuana have anything to do with
this? No. Okay. And in terms of the liver test and alcohol, they're extremely unpredictable. I have patients. I treat lots of alcoholics. Some with advanced liver disease, with normal liver enzymes. Some with no liver disease, but you know, binging on the weekends, get moderate or significant liver enzyme elevation. So the liver enzymes are not a good way to judge how much alcohol someone has been consuming. So it could be alcohol level. And sometimes people have things like alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency and things that can screw up the liver more easily with alcohol. So, you know, you need to be thoroughly tested.
Okay.
It's probably related to the alcohol, but...
Nothing. Like smoking marijuana has nothing to do with how the condition of my liver. No combination of smoking marijuana and alcohol, nothing like that, right?
I can't. I'm trying to think if it's anything they might be putting in the marijuana, but no, cannabis will not screw up your liver.
He also huffs copier toner. Yeah, is that anything?
Yeah, that's something to do with it.
So what about the combination of copier toner, cigarettes, the booze, and the weed?
Now you're in.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. All right there, Steve.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Well, you know, good times. Good times. So, Drew, let's talk enzymes for a second.
Yeah.
If you drank and you had a bender on the weekend and... someone checked your enzymes the next day, they would be raised?
Yes, could be. Maybe not, but could be.
But normally, would be, most people?
It's extremely unpredictable. Most women would have some elevation.
Because they're lightweights, right?
They lack an enzyme in their stomach to metabolize the alcohol, the things that don't cause toxicity.
I call it lightweight. Yeah. And Asians, do they have this thing too?
No, they have a different deficiency that makes them vomit, so they don't drink so much.
But good at math. And what about Asian?
Same enzyme, interestingly.
What about Asian women?
Asian women.
But they have the double sort of complex?
Again, the issue, the Asians don't drink as much, or they have to learn to drink past the vomiting.
Mm-hmm.
So they're sort of protected against the effects of alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if they get past that, then the women are more prone to liver disease than the men. About 5 times more likely to get liver problems.
Women are?
5 times
in
more
general?
Than men.
All right. And what else will bring it up? Like, what if you took some Tylenol?
Tylenol will screw it up, too. Yeah. Tylenol with alcohol is a bad combo.
But Tylenol... If you just took Tylenol, would it look different, or would it just raise the enzymes?
It depends how much you took. If you took as much as even 8 tablets, you would significantly really raise your liver enzymes for a week or so.
And so if your liver enzymes are raised for a prolonged period of time, that's when the cirrhosis kicks in?
No, liver enzymes, all it means is inflammation of the liver. That's all that means, that some cells are sort of emitting these enzymes because they're inflamed. So it could be hepatitis, could be something, you know, expanding the liver, tumor or something. I mean, it could be a hepatitis of some type, either whether a toxin or chemical or virus. He needs to have this all checked out. He needs complete what's called serology, is the viral testing of the liver for hepatitis. He needs an ultrasound of his liver. He needs to get a workup. He needs an alpha-1 antitrypsin level.
All right, so if you just drink heavily and you end up getting cirrhosis of the liver, that's not because the enzymes were raised for 20 years.
Not necessarily.
Oh, but maybe I'm right.
But many
Thank
times
you.
It can be.
Okay. Well,
but again,
there you go.
It can also be raised by
no,
a dozen
you've answered
things.
My question.
All right, good.
Thank you. The prosecution rests.
We'll be right back.
We will indeed.
Hey, everybody. It's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. I'm Adam Carolla. We're out here in Wilmington, North Carolina, doing a little Dawson's Creek this week.
You're gay.
Yeah. And the script really has me looking like a jackass, too.
Yeah.
A lot of better men would fight for this, but I just, I'm coasting down my career.
Energy, yeah.
I just realized, oh, screw it. Drew comes across looking like a saint.
Ridiculous.
The chicks are all in love with him, and I'm just this sort of womanizing buffoon who roams backstage trying to pick up chicks.
I was insulted by how you're portrayed. I thought, hey, we're professionals. We go out and speak and do these things. You know, you and I really, we... You know what I mean?
We've been on
30, 40 something college dates, and we are handle ourselves. I mean, please.
And you're playing yourselves, right?
Yeah.
We're playing ourselves, but here's the whole thing. Like, Drew, Drew's catching the early flight out, and I'm cruising backstage saying, hey, ladies, how about a ride on the Corolla coaster? And they're like, get away, creep. And I'm like, I'm just back cruising co-eds. And I'm literally saying, like, they're like, well, where did Drew go? I'm like, well, Drew always catches the early flight, but I like to hang back and cruise co-eds. And I was just so tired today, and would have taken just rewriting the script completely, and I didn't read it before I left, and I just sat back.
I encourage you to read it, though.
I know, but I just thought, oh, yeah. You know what? Oh. No, we're not getting paid anything for this. Right. They don't pay. I mean, they pay.
Not Corolla standards, though.
No.
Why are you guys doing it then?
No, you know when I was hauling to the airport on Sunday, and I was looking out, and I was like, "This is glorious! What a beautiful day!" And I was stuck in traffic, and I realized that I told Dawson's Creek that I would pay out of my own pocket to charter a plane to get there, and I was screaming at my wife, "I'm going to kill that Drew!"
Oh.
Yes, he talked me into this.
Oh, my goodness.
I don't want to do this. I was this close to just going home.
Oh.
You know how I get that? I'm going home.
Yeah,
I don't care. Let him sue me. I don't want to go. I don't want to do it. But I thought, you know, I'll tell you why I'm doing it. I'm doing it, A, because I got asked 2 months in advance. And you'll say, you guys don't realize this, you civilians. But us celebrities, we get asked to do crap like 5 years in advance.
Yeah.
It's hard to say no. They always go, in June, we're doing the hepatitis C fundraiser out in San Luis Obispo. We want to know if you can say a few words. And you're like, June, yeah. What is that, like 7 months? Yeah. I'll be there. And then before you know it, you're there standing in front of 18 people in San Luis Obispo talking about hepatitis C.
And you're pissed.
All right. But anyway, I wanted to do it because Drew and I don't go out on the road anymore because I've become too big a star.
Right.
And Drew and I like to hang out and, you know, find us. And this is a good opportunity for us to.
Anal sex or something?
Yes. Yes. And I don't think I've been to North Carolina, and I haven't spent any time
here. It's kind of for posterity's sake, too. It's kind of cool to do something like that.
Yeah, you tell your kids you're on Dawson's Creek, and they go, why are you gay, Daddy? And then they go back to Haiti. All right, shall we move forward here?
Yes.
Naomi?
Yes?
What's up?
Nothing much. How are you guys doing tonight?
We're tired.
Sort of for me, too. I should be going to bed, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's 2:00 here.
Oh, my gosh. That's crazy.
Oh, it's crazier when they pick you up in the morning.
What time can we sleep till tomorrow? 9?
Yeah, we can sleep till 9.
All right, good times.
But you go to bed at 4.
I know.
All right.
Here we go. Naomi.
Okay, well, I was wondering, regarding the conversation that you were having before about Asians and drinking and enzymes and stuff, I was actually quite interested. But I missed most of the conversation. I wanted to.
All right. What I was saying was is that many Asians are protected against alcoholism because they lack a certain enzyme that breaks down alcohol. It causes them to accumulate something that makes them vomit when they drink and flush. So they feel very uncomfortable when they drink. Now, this is particularly Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in Japan, alcohol has become so much a part of the culture that the Japanese learn to drink past the flush.
Good.
And then you see the alcoholism. What I was saying
was...
That's
the warrior spirit.
That's right. The ninja alcohol. Yeah. And what I was saying was, if you drink past the flush, you still see women having more adverse effects on their liver than men, just the way you would in any other population.
Well, that's very interesting to hear because my mother, who's Japanese, she actually doesn't drink that much because of those reactions.
Yeah.
So it protects
Japanese against alcoholism because it's so unpleasant.
She can do as much opium as she wants, though. So. All right. Hey, well, good times.
Okay.
That's
all right. So what are you? You're half Japanese?
Yes, I am.
What's your other half?
I'm Irish.
That's a dynamite mixture.
Ooh.
I know. Yeah, got like the whole alcoholic side of the family.
No, but it's a good looking mixture. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
All right, baby.
All right.
Yeah, we had good times. Good times.
Yeah, good times.
Sean, you're 24.
Yep.
What's up?
My wife has obsessive compulsive disorder, and I've kind of learned to deal with that. It's just part of life now.
How does it manifest?
Just certain things she does. The TV has to be on a certain channel when it gets turned off at night, or clothes have to be in a certain spot, or purse has to be in a certain spot.
Out of curiosity, does she smoke pot?
Nope, not at all. Never.
I've noticed that people
that and they may already be that way to begin with, but when they smoke pot, it gets, many times it gets a lot worse. It's
well, they get fastidious or something when they get they like to move stuff around and they position the salt shaker so they're facing the right way. But it doesn't seem to take over their life. It's just they get stoned and they fiddle.
Yeah, could be.
You know what I mean? But it doesn't become like what the normal OCD people have or whatever whatever we're talking about here, which is they do it 24/7.
It's disruptive, yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so Sean, what's the question?
Well, she also has a lot of anxiety.
Sure.
And lately it's been getting like really, really bad to where she has phobias of like taking pills or if she eats something, she's always afraid that she's going to get poisoned from it.
I hate those people.
Oh, boy.
She has phobias of driving alone by herself at night.
She's
going like
to screw that kid up in a big way. Yeah.
But the thing is, you know, I try to emotionally support her so much, but after a while it just gets so frustrating. Cause it's like,
well,
she needs help, but just like I was trying to get Drew not to do with young Martin, I really do believe people want to be told to shut up and get on with it half the time.
That's what I do sometimes. I try to rationalize with her as much as I can, but...
Well, here's what you need to do. You need to help her contain her behaviors, you need to be available, and then you need to take care of yourself. You can't be there 24/7.
Well, she's got to get help if she's going to be this way, because you have to explain to her that this kind of stuff freaks a kid out.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, what's the best way? Because I've seen like on TV and everything for infomercials for like these tapes.
No, it's medication.
No, you need duct tape. You need to duct tape her to the Lazy Boy, and never let her leave.
She won't take medication.
No, that's one of her big fears is pills. I mean. For an aspirin,
Jesus.
She has a headache. I have to cut the aspirin in like four pieces.
No, that's my point. Don't do it.
Well, then get her in the therapist's office and get some talk going.
Sean, here's the deal.
Okay.
Do not aid her in this. She wants, I could cure her in a week, and that's what I think she wants. But if I'm living with this broad and she's saying, cut that aspirin to four pieces, I'm like, shut your pie hole and take the aspirin. You drive me nuts. You keep acting like a mad person. You don't get any help. I'll take the kid and I'll leave. Yeah. You drive the kid nuts. And ironically, he's going to turn out like you.
Yeah.
So get it together. Get it together. That's it. Don't be cutting aspirin. Don't be quartering aspirin for her.
Yeah.
People respond amazingly well to that. And it's something that has fallen by the wayside as far as society goes.
You know what, though? A guy like that may not have the firmness in him. You know, she knows that she can undermine him because she's been doing it and doing it and doing it. It's under his skin.
Yeah. I'm telling you, people, it works. My old lady tries to give me a little grief once in a while.
Wait till you have kids.
Oh.
Oh, yeah.
They're going to hate me.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
Yeah.
Sweet justice.
You know what chicks do? Kids probably do the same thing. They give you that, you know, I'm like, look, why don't you head down the hill and pick up the Thai food? Oh, why do I have to pick up the Thai food? And I always fire right back. Yeah, see the ceiling fan and the thing? Do you see that TV over there? Do you see that? How do you think that got there? It's 100 trips to the Thai food place. Now go get it.
Yeah, and when there's a kid involved, then it's like, hey, I'm going to have my soul sucked out of here by your genetic material. Now, you go get the Thai food.
Well, I'll tell
and then
you
can go out and get the Thai food.
Maybe. I'm not going. I'll tell you one thing. I will not have a pussy for a kid. I get to one of these kids. I don't like peas. I only eat melted cheese. I don't like regular cheese.
God, I cannot wait until this moment arrives
now,
when this man has children.
I will refuse. I work with a hand because I work with writers, and they're half of them are Jewish, and all of them are neurotic. And I see these guys, and
they won't drive cars.
They can take their sandwich and open them up and scrape stuff off it and stuff every day. And I'm looking at these guys; they're 30 years old, you know, and they're pulling the lettuce off of the turkey sandwich. And I think, oh, if you were my kid, I swear to Christ, I'd put a bullet in your head while you're asleep. I'd make you change your name and get a nose job, so no one knew who you were. And I can't stand those little fussy. My kid is luck.
We'll see. Yeah.
I decided this food is good. Here it is. You don't want to eat it? Don't eat it.
We'll see. Good time.
Drew, why can't you do that to a fussy eating kid? Eat it if you don't want to eat it.
Yeah, you can. You can.
Oh, my God. Is that?
But it's work because they don't stop there. They keep coming. They keep coming. And they find ways to get under your skin.
And my kids are going to be scared of me, though. And that's the way I like it. Kyle?
Yeah.
You're 15?
Right.
What's up?
Hey, Adam.
Hey.
Love you, man.
Love you, Kyle.
Yeah?
Love you, buddy.
Hey. All right. I got a question for Drew.
Yeah.
Drew, now, I know you're a passionate man.
It's just saying, Kyle, somehow having a 15-year-old male say that to me, I find it very disturbing.
It is true, though. He is so passionate.
Oh, I know.
What the...
All right, Drew, seriously.
Yeah, Kyle, seriously.
I know. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, are you a real doctor? You're just a love doctor.
All right.
This is your Adam Carolla.
All right, Kyle, please.
You're gay.
You have a question.
I don't know.
No. All right. You just wanted to say hi?
Yeah.
Have you called before?
Yeah.
Yeah. You've done imitations of Adam before, right? He's the guy who does the ferret on double cappuccino, right?
I don't know. Mm-hmm. Kyle, do you do an Adam Carolla impersonation?
No, I don't know what he's talking about.
Mm. All right. Good times, buddy.
Oh, yeah.
Good times.
Or at least say good times.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Good times.
All right. Good. He gave the throwaway good times. I like that.
Danielle.
Hi.
Hey.
What's up?
How are you? My question is I have just lost my vision this last June.
Completely?
In both eyes?
Completely, yes. Well, the first eye I lost back when I was in eighth grade, I had a cornea transplant and it didn't work.
Why?
I guess it just didn't like my body.
Why did you need a corneal transplant?
Well, I was born with glaucoma, aniridia, and cataracts. But it wasn't, like, really bad, exactly. I could still see pretty well. Just couldn't see really small print or anything. But, you know, going through life...
And iridia, no iris?
Yeah, I didn't have any pupils.
The colored part of your eye.
Wow.
Yeah, it was pretty cool.
Spirits about this.
Yeah.
All
right, so what do you see now? Do you see light?
I see dark. All dark.
Just dark,
whoa.
Just black.
Oh, my goodness.
And it's really messed up my sleeping schedules and stuff. I mean, I've had 24-hour non-sleep, you know, because, you know, sometimes I just can't sleep, and then sometimes I can sleep all day long, and just, I don't know, it's just been really crazy. But
So the lack of light is screwing up the brain chemistry.
Yeah, yeah.
Interesting.
And you know, when people say, oh, yeah, you know, try to describe something to me, I can't even picture it in my head. I don't know, like... They say, do you see colors? I'm like, no.
But you did it one time, though, right?
I did. Yes, I did. But since I lost my vision, no, I haven't.
But if somebody says picture a car.
I try to, but it's very difficult. I can't remember sometimes. Or I remember, but just it won't come to my brain. Like somebody said I had like a brain lock of something or other, and I'm like, oh no, it's not good.
Has there been some effect in the brain visual center somehow?
I have no idea. I had a cornea transplant this summer too. I had a cornea transplant, and they thought that would help because, you know, they found out in June that, you know, they had no idea why I'd lost my vision, you know, because, you know, I had pretty good vision up until then.
June.
Yeah, in June. And so they were like, well, let's do a cornea transplant and see if that works. So they did that, and it didn't work.
wait a minute, Danny. Have you seen a neuro-ophthalmologist?
What's that?
it's really a neurologist that specializes in eye function.
They work on your brain, not your eye, right?
Oh, no, I've never seen
it. You really should do that. You really should.
That's good, because I've kind of wanted to know. So.
Hey, I got a bunch of questions for you.
Are you having any other numbness or tingling in any other part of your body?
No. Not that I know of. Not that I've noticed, but it's probably happened.
Have you learned to read Braille at all?
Yeah. But I'm a very, very slow reader.
But you just learned that in the last few months?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. See, that'd be it for me. I just get a coffee can and go down to the corner and just, like, please throw some nickels in here. Actually, that's one of my plans now.
Yeah, I was going to say.
20/20 vision. And do you feel, do you understand, you know, Drew and I always say that because of the radio, we can read people's voices better than we can if we see them in person.
Mm-hmm.
We can know more about the person.
We just can feel it. You just respond to feeling.
Do you feel that's becoming more acute with you or sensitive?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I definitely have toned in on all my senses. hearing is, I wouldn't say it's like ultra sensitive hearing, but you know, I can hear things I concentrated on more. And when I first lost my vision, like I woke up, this is the day that I woke up and I didn't know what time it was because it was all dark. And I mean, I just woke up and it was dark.
Wow.
And I was like,
have you had an MRI of your brain?
Never. So I,
Danielle, you need an MRI.
Doesn't seem like someone should be doing that for her.
Yeah, please call us back, will you? Let us know what happens with this. You need to see a neurologist, all right?
All right.
Promise me you'll do that.
I will promise you, because I would really like to know why. I mean,
your attitude about it, your sort of indifference, you know, your positivity about it, mm-hmm. certain neurologic conditions have that as part of the syndrome. They mm-hmm. call it Belle Indifference, Adam.
Well, La Belle Indifference. Here's what I say. I say if that neuropathy causes this jovial attitude, sign me up.
Hello?
Yeah, what's up there, Shannon?
Ahead?
Yeah, go.
Of course. Okay, I have several questions for Dr. Drew. Mm-hmm. I experienced a missed miscarriage mm-hmm. about a week ago, mm-hmm. or I guess sometimes they call it a missed abortion.
Mm-hmm. What's a missed miscarriage?
It is when the fetus dies and it doesn't, you don't go through the normal behaviors of a miscarriage, like bleeding.
You don't know that you've miscarried.
Right.
So it was missed.
Right. Yeah, like I went in for my prenatal appointment.
Ooh.
And they just couldn't find the heartbeat. And
right. Ooh. Couldn't find anything.
Did you freak out?
Well, of course.
Yeah.
Pretty
traumatizing,
traumatic.
Yeah.
Yeah. So one question I have is, I found out in that prenatal appointment when I went into the ultrasound after they couldn't find the heartbeat that it was actually twins. And this was at my 16-week appointment, ooh. And the doctor had not detected that it was twins earlier. So
how did they know it was twins at the time of the discovery of an abortion?
Pardon?
How did they know it was twins now?
Because they did an ultrasound at that prenatal appointment. He couldn't find the heartbeat, so we went in and did an ultrasound immediately. And he saw the twins in the ultrasound.
Oh, so you didn't even have a missed abortion. You had.
No, I didn't have any. I mean,
it's called intrauterine demise.
Yeah, exactly. Like yeah. when he scheduled the procedure, he called it a fetal demise.
Yeah,
that was the name of my band in junior high. And was he freaking out when he was like looking for the heartbeat, not finding it?
No, he was really calm and professional. I didn't expect that either. It was pretty shocking.
Jeez, the petals of a flower constituting the inner flora envelope surrounding the sporophyll.
That's where the corolla is.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. So.
All right. Yeah, we got problems over here too. You know, Shannon.
Okay. So my first question is, I'm just confused about why he could not detect that it was twins at earlier.
It's very difficult. Oh, it's almost impossible without ultrasound.
But you know, everybody else who I know who's had twins, but I had an ultrasound. I had an intravaginal ultrasound at 8 weeks.
Even then, it's very difficult. We thought we had quadruplets. At the beginning. And then they couldn't tell, and they didn't know how many, and maybe it was triplets. It's very difficult. Look, you're looking at a single plane view of a three-dimensional, and it's sort of an ice pick through, which is what ultrasound is, a three-dimensional system, and it's very difficult sometimes.
What's the intravaginal one?
You send a probe up the vagina.
No.
You've never seen those?
I don't know if I've seen them or not. I let me tell you something.
Oh, you got a lot to learn, Daddy.
I was at the, like I said, I was at the man show today, and one of our cue card guys just had a kid about a week ago. And he's like, you know, showing people pictures. And he's, hey, here, yeah, look at her. Look at him. He's, look at him here. And then he's like, here he is coming out. And I averted my gaze. I said,
out of respect.
The guy's showing the pic. I don't know if it's his wife's vagina that I'm looking at or, like, what's going on? Which people are, you know what I mean? I mean. I understand it's your kid. That's great. Let's see some pictures. You hose the kid down. You put the little beanie on his head. He's in the swaddling clothes. No, let me have a look. But coming out of the wife's coos.
Nice.
Covered with blood. It's, I don't know. Is that?
You're lucky you didn't pull out a video camera. Think about that.
Or do a reenactment. I mean, maybe it's just me, but I find that a little invasive.
I
don't want to see
that.
We
had none of that. None of that.
And the guys that are filming and everything.
And by the way,
what?
It gets emblazoned in your memory. You know,
I beat off in 2.5 hours.
No, I don't mean the seeing these things again and again on pictures.
Hold on, I'm sorry. 2 hours, 22 minutes.
At 45 seconds?
Yeah, because I'll be home at 12:23. Right.
You and the rat?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Oh. But go ahead.
But the experience becomes emblazoned in your memory. Almost, you don't want to say, spoil it with, like, reenactments and pictures. You know what I mean? You have your memory, and that's something you cherish, and that's that.
All right.
Anyway, she has more questions, she said.
Shannon?
Hello?
Yeah, you're here.
All right. I have several more questions.
Right. Yeah, I know. We put you on hold, though, because okay, I don't want you interrupting really my jag.
Right.
Okay. So I've been trying to find more information about this very rare type of miscarriage, and
it's not rare at all.
Well, it just doesn't seem like I can find much about it, especially since it happened in the
about fetal demise.
Especially since it happened in the second trimester. Most of the information I found talks about this happening at 5 weeks mm-hmm. or 7 weeks.
That's true.
Whatever.
That's the more serious stuff. But you do need to research this a little bit. You need to talk to someone about what happened and what might have gone wrong and what the risks were for you particularly.
Well, that's what I'm confused about.
Not a 50% of pregnancies end prematurely. Now, yes, it's not
50%, really?
Yeah, it's not that
almost
common.
Almost half.
Not that common during the second trimester, but fetal demise at any stage is something that happens.
Hello?
Yeah. Fetal demise at almost any stage is something that happens,
right?
Shannon.
Yeah, I understand that. Okay. But what confuses me more is the more I've read about it, especially in the second trimester, it seems to suggest that incompetent cervix would be
causes. Yeah, but you didn't have that.
Right. Okay. So that's a logical conclusion that's probably not going to be a problem for me because I would have gone through a normal miscarriage.
All right, that's enough. Yeah, you're
going to keep having more and more and more questions because you want to control this and make it better and make sure it doesn't happen again, which is that's not the way nature works. We're talking about human biology here, and you can't control everything. Yes, it's worthwhile looking into what the risks were for you, what might have happened. But you're going to sit down with your doctor and plan it out and be more careful perhaps in terms of how it's followed up because you're now a high-risk pregnancy. Perhaps you want to see a high-risk obstetrician this time.
Who's this?
Hello?
Was that say anonymous?
That's what it says.
Hey, who's doing the phone screening over there tonight?
Sir? Oh.
Okay, don't write anonymous. Okay.
Hello? It went on hold and came back, it erased the name.
Ah. Uh-huh.
So what's going on? Hello?
Hello?
What can we do for you?
Me?
Okay. Listen, Anderson, hang up on this person. Or put them on hold. Thank you.
let's talk to Neil, who's 24. Neil?
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Good.
Dude, I've been waiting so long to get on. About 2 years ago, actually,
that's
it'd be about
time.
3 years ago, I called in and Dr. Drew, it told me that I was overdosing on Ultram. Mm.
What's Ultram?
It's an opiate.
All right.
I tried to stop taking it, and I had an appointment scheduled about a week later. I had a serious car accident, and I had a lapse of consciousness while I was driving. I hit a brick wall at about 60 miles an hour and crushed both my legs.
Great.
Was in the hospital for a couple of months. And I was,
let me ask something real quick. Is that the proverbial brick wall, or did you actually hit a brick wall? Like,
no,
it was really like cinder block there.
It was
right?
A brick wall, and the scary thing was it was a side of a school. Mm-hmm. And I was lucky because it was on a Saturday and no one was there. Wow. I also went through a bus stop before I hit the brick wall. Mm-hmm. And the thing I was wondering is, I was taking the other stuff to not take the narcotics, and now I'm on stronger narcotics, MS Continent and Norco.
Okay.
And I was wondering if in the long term, is this a long term solution?
No. You're just on to stronger, much more intense opiates.
Why? Because of the injuries?
Because of the injury, but he's an addict, and the disease is progressing, and the injury is just sort of.
Well, I never really had a problem with addiction as far as the medicine. I can't stop, but I have a bunch of injuries in my legs. I still have osteomyelitis and some other, a lot of bone problems. I probably might have one of my left foot amputated. The thing is is this just going to...
Really? How long ago was the accident?
2 years ago.
They're going to take the foot now?
Yeah, the bone started after, I guess...
You got to pay your bills.
I know, they kicked me out of the hospital.
They really said they're going to amputate your foot 2 years after the accident?
Yeah, I have a lot of bone problems with, I guess after the accident, the ankle bones are real small and fragile, and they just stopped growing, and they actually started dying. So they fused my ankle, but the bone is so badly
decomposed,
healed, right? So it started dying again. So they took so much out the first time that basically they just got to cut it off, because there's not a lot of bone otherwise to work around in there.
What's your nationality?
White.
Really?
Yeah, I'm sick right now.
It's usually they wait on the white people. I know it's the black folks. They take their limbs off. Look at he split.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, no, I mean it. This is the greatest form of racism. All those old black stars and stuff.
Like,
pow, yeah.
Well, I don't know, because I'm on the county medical services.
No, all right. So you're not getting the best money can't buy. But
Neil, here's the deal. You are an addict. I know you're having trouble coming to terms with that. But that's how you got yourself in this mess, is because of your addiction to Ultram. And
I'd only taken Ultram for about 2 months.
Listen. You better come to terms with this, because it's the main problem you're dealing with. It's why you're in the condition you're in. Now, that doesn't mean you don't have real sources of pain, and it just makes it that much more difficult to get off these substances.
Now, controlling it the way I have, like not calling for early refills or not saying my dog ate it.
No, that's addict behavior. But listen, you ought to talk to them about being an addict and about having chronic pain. And there's a school of thought, I happen to not be of this school of thought, but there are people out there that feel very strongly that someone like you should be on methadone.
I went to UCSD, and they said I could either do the MS-Contin or
methadone.
What's MS-Contin?
Morphine, long-acting morphine.
Ooh.
And the narco, I don't really take much of that, just because I know I could get hooked on that really.
Well, you are.
I try to keep my dose down. I take one or two a day at the most.
All right, so, Neil.
What's your question, then?
Is this kind of medicine, is this going to be, if the prognosis is a lot of pain for the rest of my future, which is what it looks like, are these medicines I would be taking for a long time, or would they?
But even if you didn't have pain, you would insist on something like this. So I think methadone may be in your future.
All right, so he's got to get in a program.
Or not? A maintenance program, maybe. Because he doesn't sound like he's motivated or interested in a real program.
Getting off things.
He's got chronic pain. I personally hate methadone. But methadone...
Makes me vomit.
But methadone, there's a whole school of thought that someone like this should be in what's called a harm avoidance treatment program, where he's refusing to come off opiates, he's refusing to identify as an addict, he's got a real source of chronic pain that's going to make it almost impossible to be off opiates. In terms of the addictive process, methadone lessens some of that.
Lena?
Hello.
Hi, what's going on?
Hi. I don't know. Recently, I've been having this problem where I would just eat lots and lots and lots, and I would get really sick, and then I'd make myself throw up.
Okay, so after that. So that's bulimia, right?
Yeah, all but right. I mean, I don't do it lots and lots. I don't do it really frequently.
Well, doing it once is consistent with bulimia.
Really?
No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
Too.
Consistent with bulimia. Well, binge eating, you don't have to purge, and she is purging also on top of that.
Yeah.
She makes herself throw up. Okay. And, that's the syndrome.
Like, what can I expect from this? I mean, how?
One out of five bulimics will die of that disease if it gets to severe proportions. You need to get seen by a mental health professional right away. This is going to be a chronic thing. You're going to have to deal with it. It's a sign that something substantial is going on with you, and it needs to be dealt with. You could eventually they will do some sort of purging. They'll do laxatives or something. I mean, let's look it up.
We're just going to look it up. That book is some of the greatest radio you've ever done, Drew. Where you
right.
just
but it,
through
it,
the book.
It is something that you really need to get looked into, right?
I mean,
did your mom put you in ballet class when you were young?
No.
Piano?
No.
Violin?
None of that.
Tuba?
No.
No, this is more...
Oboe, French horn?
No, it's...
This is chaos.
No.
This is managing chaos.
What's chaotic in your life right now?
No, early.
Oh, early. What was chaotic in your life?
Not too much. I mean, my parents divorced, but that's pretty common.
Yeah. What else?
What were the circumstances of the divorce?
My mom left.
Why?
Because my dad was an alcoholic and he was always...
Gone. Okay. Well, that's chaos. That's good enough, Lena. All right, you have an excuse, and you have an answer now. Now you got to get some help so you don't get out of control of this, right?
Is this something that I can just, can I work this through on my own?
No.
Why
it's
not?
It doesn't work like that. It's too dangerous a disorder to leave to just...
But she's only done it once, right? couple times?
Not once, but just like not real frequently. I mean, it's been more recently that it's been.
No, you got to talk to somebody.
What kinds of problems?
Death.
Really?
1 out of 5. Enamel come off your teeth. You get esophageal problems, bowel motility disorders, electrolyte disturbances.
How long before that happens?
Hard to tell.
Next week.
Hard to tell.
You got to talk to someone, Lena. Don't be goofball with this thing.
Starts swelling up. It's just a big mess. Kidney disease.
You understand?
Yeah, I gotcha.
You're screwing with yourself in a big way. God, imagine what your body must think of that. You dump a bunch of stuff in it. It starts going, all right, let's metabolize. And then you spit it back out again. Hey, it's the Love Line. I'm Adam Carolla. It's Dr. Drew over there. Dr. Drew, board certified physician. Dixon Medicine. Hold on a second. 1-800. There we go. Tiffany.
Yeah.
16. Yeah. You want to drop the LSD into your eye?
Well, yeah. First, can I say hi to everybody in Tucson?
Yeah, Tucson's a lovely town.
Yeah.
I've been there once. That's plenty.
Yeah.
We're going back again this spring.
Really?
Yeah, we are.
You serious?
Yeah. I'm going to the University of Arizona twice.
You are?
Yeah. I'm going to speak at their commencement.
Oh, that's a mistake.
You're going once at the... Everything I do is a mistake as far as you're concerned. The scary thing is you say something like that and it gets to me.
I know. That's the beauty of it. I can talk to you on anything. I can tell him his pants were on fire. He'd run around try to jump in a pool. Tiffany?
Tiffany, look. How much do you do acid? How much do you drop acid? How often? How often do you drop acid?
Have I ever dropped acid?
How often?
I dropped it like maybe twice a month, three times a month.
Okay. I promise you will have consequences from this.
Well, okay? Like...
It is the scariest drug out there. I have to deal with adults every day who are either at least chronically depressed, panic attacks, some of them terribly disabled from this drug, and often the symptoms don't usually... The symptoms don't develop until 5 to 10 years after you stop using the LSD. Mm. If you continue to see trailers after fast-moving objects, do you still see trailers?
Yeah, sometimes.
Okay. That is from brain damage. And that's a sign that you're one of these people that is going to have severe problems with this. Okay? You got to stop. You've got to stop.
What about putting it in the eye?
Well, one of my friends told me that it intensifies and it makes it better, but I wanted to know if it would, like, make me blind or anything.
I'm not aware of that. I've heard of people doing it.
How do you put it in your eye? You gotta stick that blotter right to your eye?
It's a little paper, and you just stick it in your eye.
Isn't that just what I said? Hold on, didn't I just say that?
Basically.
Yeah.
Look, however you do it...
You stick the paper onto your eye?
It just makes it go into your system quicker, just rapidly absorbed.
I know, but how the hell do you... Oh, you do? Oh, Drew, just show me. Drew, you done it?
No, but it's like I've done things on paper that you have to get in the eye.
Oh, really?
Like, how about when you have your eye dilated or dyed for examination?
Go for that.
I don't know. I haven't done it in my eye yet.
All right. All right, Tiffany.
Knock it off.
You've got to stop. You've got to stop. It is, to me, I would much rather see somebody addicted to cocaine than doing LSD regularly, because the cocaine we can treat, we can deal with the addiction, but the damage done by the LSD is just irreversible.
How about heroin?
I'd almost rather see somebody using heroin. Heroin does not hurt anything, does not harm the body in any way.
Say heroin's good for anything like that.
No. The heroin causes the medical problems by virtue of the behaviors that manifest from the severe addiction and the route in which you give it. You inject it, and people inject all kinds of crap into the system and create all kinds of problems that way. But the heroin itself does not hurt a thing.
It's good for
you? Not good for you. No. It doesn't hurt anything.
Okay. So if they made heroin in a pill form, it'd be all right?
It would be, they do. They call it Vicodin.
Oh, really?
And it's better than shooting it, but it still causes the same addictive disease, which is terrible.
Mike, get on that internet and score me some Vicodin, would you? I've never tried the Vicodin.
Hi, Drew. Where are we going? Who's got a problem? I need to fix kids.
Steven's got
a problem. That's my drug, fixing kids. You know what I'm saying?
Steven?
Steven?
Yeah?
Ooh. Science, ooh, you're 12?
Yeah.
Yeah. You're, where are you calling from?
El Sobrani.
Where's that?
In California.
Okay.
Yeah, everything with an L in it has to either be in Texas, Arizona, or
Mexico,
California. Yeah, so we don't want the Mexicans to jump the border, but everything's got a goddamn L in it. What kind of strategy is that, Drew?
Well, they used to own it, that's why.
I know, but we want to keep them out of Chula Vista and Isla Vista and all that, Los Angeles. And all that. Come on. All
right, Stevens, what's the question?
Hang on one second.
All right.
He's running the water so nobody hears.
The door open like he's living in a haunted shed.
Deal with him. Make sure he gets reports that he got somebody touching him, he says.
All right, let's see if he's around. Steven?
What?
Yeah. Oh, Dad.
I got the number. Huh. I made up this question. I said my science teacher was molesting me. Oh. It's a question. No one even knows who I am. I made up a fake name.
We'll trace it, Steve. We will.
Hello?
Hello.
Who's this?
This is Loveline. Who's this?
Oh, this is his son, and he's just telling you guys a story.
Why?
Why?
Well, why do you know it's a story?
That his science teacher's molesting him?
Yeah.
You tell him. You tell him the truth, Mikey.
It was a lie.
Really?
Yeah.
Why would you make that up?
I don't know.
Is your science teacher molesting you?
Hang up. That was nice.
That was lovely.
That now we know why kids like that call a lie.
Yeah.
Probably a lot of that didn't go over the air with the dad being abusive to the kid.
Well, we just missed the F word there, right? Yeah. Why? What else did we miss, Drew?
I don't know how much he drops out. I don't know how much.
I don't know how much I can hear because it's pretty quiet.
Yeah.
All right. That's a little that disturbing. Delightful.
Karen.
Hey.
You're 22.
Yes, I am.
What's going on?
Well, you had a caller last night on Lena. She's wondering about her beginning bulimia and how that's going to affect her life.
Right.
Well, I'm a prime example of that. I just kind of wanted to...
Hey, by the way, one of the things I did not clarify last night was how long you have to be doing it to be considered bulimia. I think it's twice a week over 3 months.
That's by the court. I think you have to throw up...
And, we were saying it's not just one time, and I looked up exactly how frequently. It was once or twice a week over 3 months.
Well, I started anorexic, and then now I'm up to like 10 to 12 times throwing up a day. It's not the throwing up.
10 or 12 times a day, you're
at? Yes, I'm not doing well at all.
That's a lot, right?
It's a lot, but the thing is, it's not like throwing up like you know it, because you throw up so immediately that it doesn't have the time to build up the acid. So it doesn't, it's not, I mean, not to get too graphic. But
it's still, believe me, the pH is still very low, and you'll take the enamel right off your teeth, so.
I know, my teeth hurt.
Yeah.
My question is, my behaviors, I cannot figure myself out. I'm really getting impulsive about, like, stealing, which has started with food and is now turning to other things. Yes. I'm not sure. I can't find anywhere where the correlation is between stealing and the bulimia. I've also...
Well, both of them, interestingly, are ways of activating reward systems in the brain that are activated by thrill.
Yeah.
Okay? And people that are particularly rewarded by thrill tend to be alcoholic.
Mm-hmm.
Is that in your family system somewhere?
I believe, yeah.
So have you ever had momentum with drugs or alcohol?
No, I refuse to go near them.
Because you have a suspicion?
Yeah, I'll have too much fun with them, I know it.
Right, so you have the gene, and that's what you're up to here.
Well, let me ask a quick question.
Let me just finish. Stealing and vomiting are ways of managing and avoiding very painful feelings.
Yeah.
By activating thrill and sort of euphoria of some sort.
Karen?
Yes?
Why do you need to vomit 10 or 12 times a day?
It is, I don't know. All I want to do is eat. And eating means throwing up. I can't keep anything in. It started with the high. You know how when you have the flu and you throw up and you have that ah sensation? Like better?
Yeah, when you're done. Actually, I did that and it wasn't Tijuana.
Really?
Yeah, I felt much better. So the kind of woke me up.
We're happy for you.
It's that it started with that, and I loved that I was like, oh my gosh, I just ate a whole pizza and it's gone. And I look still anorexic, but I eat like a horse, and so it cracks people up. I scare waitresses, and I just wanted to warn Lena, who called the other night, that it takes over your life, and I'm wasting my whole life in the Taco Bell drive-thru.
How soon?
You're not going to live your whole life.
Well, so are the people working there, by the way.
You have any treatment?
I've been hospitalized like 3 times. I'm waiting to get back.
Medically hospitalized or psychiatrically hospitalized?
Therapy.
psychiatric.
All right. Right.
I fought it both the last two times.
Please go to OA or some sort of recovery program.
What is a good group to go to?
Well, you're asking me sort of a wholesale question. I mean,
right.
OA has, as you know, eating disorder groups, and there are groups around that are specifically for eating disorder. I mean, whatever group you were hooked up with, get back involved with. I'm sure there's an ongoing process.
You know,
there.
I swear to God, my mom ought to open a halfway house because, believe me, a couple of days living over at my mom's house, she's serving up the chickpea soup and whole lentil bean salad. And you're like, even the most anorexic and bulimic would look at my, I'm going to turn in early.
That's what I need.
Have some peanut butter that's still in the shell with no salt in it. Or if you like, we could have the one that's seasoned with kelp. I'm going to turn in.
I'd even pass on that
Karen,
one.
Karen, how fast after you eat do you need to throw up?
It takes over your mind. You start, all your thoughts.
All right, but let's say we were out on a date.
Right. I'd love that.
Okay.
All right. Hello. You have a girlfriend, don't you?
Yeah.
That sucks. I know.
Yeah,
I think you should raffle off like a date with Adam and Drew.
Yeah. Okay.
Have a
what would we do with the $8?
Have a contest.
And less than six of it would go to Drew.
So we're out on
All right, listen, Karen, though. We're out on a date.
And we start making out.
No, no.
Quickly. Karen, you have some sexual compulsion stuff here, too.
Very much. Can you sense it?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And then that's part of the... It's all the same stuff.
Yeah.
Okay, it's all avoiding real feelings.
See, what Drew has to jump in and ruin it. I just want to know, I don't want to get sexual. I'm just saying if we go out on a date and we're eating, and like I usually will go, I'll take a date to like Sizzler, let's say. I like the, you know, because I got the all you can eat. And they got the Sunday bar, so you can have dessert and that's no extra.
Hello.
Yeah, oh yes. Only the best. You get the Langostino. That's the miniature lobster there. And I'll get the Malibu chicken. And the point is we eat, when do you have to excuse yourself to the bathroom?
Well, on a date, it's easy because he can't follow. When I'm with a girl, it's terrible because she'll say, oh, I'll come with. And I'm like, no, you won't.
They can eat for a while. I mean, it depends. When they're full, that's when they go.
My limit is 1 hour. After 1 hour, I panic and I start saying, okay, it's digesting. I have got to go.
Mm-hmm.
And I will knock over anything, anybody to get to the bathroom. I'll even... Mm-hmm. Throw up on your shoes. I mean, I've never.
I'll tell you when you got the addiction gene going with eating disorder, it is just intense. It really goes.
See, I would look at that as such a waste of money.
Right now, no. When I'm doing okay, I can usually keep beverages down, which sounds pitiful. But when I'm not doing well, that's pretty good.
Part of the problem, Karen, you're not.
What if you drink? Can you drink? I don't mean to kind of, but like Ensure and V8 and stuff that's got something in it.
Right. Like coffee coolers, like Frappuccinos, I'm cool with.
You're very good natured about this, but you got to begin to accept the reality here that your life is in grave danger from this illness. I mean, grave danger. These are the people that die, and they die fast.
Grave means slight.
And once these things get a certain irreversible cycle, there becomes heart muscle damage, arrhythmias, the body starts auto-digesting. It is a mess.
Yeah, because you're freaking your body out
in
a huge
mess.
Way,
and
aren't
once,
you?
Once you sort of head down that spiral, this sort of at some point there's no turning back.
Mm.
And she could get there without knowing it.
Nathan?
Hey.
You're 18?
Yeah, I am.
What's up?
I've just been getting real kind of violent tendencies here lately. And I kind of know why they're there. I never really expect them to be there because I didn't think anything was really wrong with me until just recently.
What'd you do?
Oh, I didn't do anything. It's just, I kind of had a bad childhood and I never really, as I got older, I knew I had a bad childhood, but I never really thought it affected me any until just recently.
What happened in your childhood?
A lot of stuff. You know, it started when I was like seven.
A lot of stuff.
When I was seven, and my dad got stabbed to death.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, my mom was with like, I don't know, a whole bunch of different guys, and some of them would beat her, and me and my brothers would have to chase them out of the house, coffee cups and knives and all kinds of stuff.
Who stabbed your dad?
His name was Rodney. That's all I know. I mean, it's just
Ooh,
some guy.
Rodney.
My mom was separated from my dad at the time, and my dad went over to her house to take a shower or something, and the guy was celebrating his birthday, and he came home because my dad
disconnected a phone call from him and my mom because he owed my mom, or my mom owed him some money, and he got all mad about it. Came over there, and they got into a fight, and my dad got stabbed.
Wow.
A couple times. And the guy went out and celebrated his birthday some more, and the cops arrested him.
No, he sounds like a dynamite individual.
But this was your mom's, this was your mom's boyfriend at the time?
I really don't know about that. I kind of have a feeling it was, but I don't know.
It was her boyfriend. That's why you got angry, because your dad was taking a shower at his girlfriend's house.
Well, your mom sounds like a real class act.
Oof.
Oh, boy.
No, my mom really is a really good woman. And it's my dad, he was into a lot of drugs and everything like that. And there's really no telling what went on.
Yeah, but your mom is a really good woman, but your mom dated a guy who ultimately killed your dad, and then she dated a succession of a-holes that beat on her, and you had to chase out of the house with a coffee mug.
All right, so obviously now you have trouble with aggression yourself. So how can we help you?
I was kind of wondering if you had, like lately, I just kind of have to stop myself from doing something like that might something violent, you know, because I feel like I'm just gonna like attack somebody or it's something doesn't
we get it. Hey, you know, Nathan,
yeah,
I just got back from a maximum security prison a few weeks ago.
Uh-huh.
And there's a whole bunch of guys in there that really just did something bad once. And they're not O.J., and they're not Klaus von Bureau, and they're in there for the rest of their lives. They're just rotting away in prison.
What happens with the guys like Nathan is there are parts of the brain that sort of shrink that are there to contain aggression. And so the biology, the anatomy isn't there to help him.
Oh, all right. You got to kill then.
Well, no, but maybe he... but I'm not so sure that taking him to the high, you know...
Well, listen,
the penitentiary is going to deter him, but maybe...
Well, I'm just sharing my experience and trying to dissuade him
way. I know. Are you a religious guy, Nathan?
Absolutely not.
No.
Good boy. Good boy.
So I was wondering, that kind of thing might help him. You know, connection with a...
Yeah. You know? Some of it, too. Hey, Nathan?
Yes?
Let me tell you a little something about life. I was going to break into song, but I realized I didn't have one. Here's the deal. There's the kind of person you are, and then there's the kind of person you act like. And if you could be a person that has some bad thoughts and some violent thoughts, but if you put together enough days, enough months, enough years where you don't do anything violent, then that becomes the kind of person you are.
Mm-hmm.
Even though it might come more naturally to other people, I mean, they may go 5 years without getting into a scrape, and they may never plan on it. And for Nathan, he may have to think about it every day. And it may be a little more work for you, but you can be that kind of person.
Mm-hmm.
You just have to you just have to keep your eyes open, and you can't do stuff like go out and get loaded a lot, because that's where the trouble's going to start.
Mm-hmm.
And you got to sort of nip things in the bud. Like, you can't decide it's going to be a good idea to start carrying a knife, or it's going to be a great idea to put a Glock in your glove box or something like that, because then that leads to trouble.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's almost like you have to child-proof your house against you, except for with weapons and situations.
Good advice.
Yeah, I mean, look, here's the problem with a lot of people. They have impulse control.
Mm-hmm.
But if there's no gun to go running for and there's no knife to pull from your boot, then the impulse doesn't really amount to that much oftentimes.
Not the kind of disaster it could be.
Yeah, it's the a-holes who say, I'm going to put this knife in my boot, I'm going to keep it there for protection. Then they go get drunk, and some guy shoves them around and insults them, and they get thrown out of the bar. And then they come back and stab the guy with the knife. As it turns out, it wasn't there for the guy's protection, and now the guy's doing life in prison.
Right.
He is.
I mean, yes, you is. Yes, he proverbially is.
The royal you.
The royal you is. So, Nathan, A, avoid all this kind of stuff, the knife in the boot and gun in the glove box sort of thing. But two, I think he's got to get some counseling too, right?
Yeah, but
what?
See, that's what I was thinking about, more like a religious kind of thing, because he needs a connection with a group. He needs somebody to help contain him.
All right.
This is Nathan.
When's the last time you really took a good look at Jesus Christ?
I don't think I ever really took a good look at him.
Yeah.
Maybe when I was seven. when I was seven, I was starting to believe in him.
Well, you find Jesus.
My dad got stabbed to death.
Yeah,
kind of blew that all to hell. And I kind of just ignored him the whole rest of the time. Yeah, my life.
A connection with something transcendent might really help me.
Well, what about Buddha or Allah or Bodhisattva? No.
No, just atheist.
Yeah, atheist. Mm. All right, but atheists usually aren't that violent, ironically.
Mm.
Well, you say that, but what percentage of guys in prison for violent crimes are atheists, Drew?
All right.
That's always my argument.
But think about... Think about Nathan. I mean, what's he going to go to? Anger management class?
I don't know.
It's not very specific.
Nathan, no booze. Watch it with the booze and watch it with the weapons.
That's another big problem of mine. I'm a real big alcoholic.
All right.
Well, there is some place you can focus your attention.
Right.
Go to AA, get a sponsor, work the program. Forget what I said about the church. Go right to AA, and you'll find a connection there, and that'd be fine.
Lisa?
Lisa, 29.
All right. I'm going to put Lisa on hold and speak to...
Hello?
Leslie.
Yes.
23. What's up?
What's up?
You sound hot, baby.
No.
No?
Yeah, maybe.
What's up?
Well, you know, listening to y'all. You guys are funny.
Great. Man, calling from Van Nuys, huh?
Yeah, unfortunately.
Yeah, you got to get out of that pit.
Yeah, I just moved here, actually.
Oh,
that's stupid.
It's horrendous.
I know. Nothing worse. No worse place to spend a summer, by the way, than Van Nuys.
Well, it'll be nice. 105 all week this week.
Yeah.
Yeah, nice soupy, thick air, and you get to see a lot of crazy people just walking around in the sun waiting to die. It's wonderful.
Exactly.
A lot of green.
You feel my pain.
Yeah. All right, so what's up?
Well, basically, I've been seeing my boyfriend. We were engaged, actually, but I broke it off for a year and a half.
Why? Why'd you break it off?
Oh, God. You guys will be here all night, but to make a long story short, my family didn't like his background.
Which was what?
He's an ex-drug user, abuser, and he got out of all that, and I, you know, gave him the benefit of the doubt, and they, you know, made me break it off with him at a point where it wasn't really necessary.
They made you break it off with him?
I've been controlled by my family for 23 years.
At the point, what wasn't really necessary?
For me to break it off with him.
Why did they suggest you do that?
Because they felt in their hearts that I was unhappy.
Were you?
Yes and no.
They felt in their hearts that you were unhappy.
Honestly, that's exactly how I feel. Like it's kind of torn because, you know, when your family comes into play, you want to give them, you know, it's your family, so no one else would come before your family.
No, really? Not me. I got a long list of people that come before this.
But
wait a minute. Where did you grow up?
I grew up in California.
Where?
Culver City in West Hollywood.
Okay, and so your family still resides there?
They're from London.
I see. That's where that weird, accent you have.
I don't have a weird accent.
There's something's going on, but I wouldn't have guessed London, that's for sure. Okay, so you broke it off with this guy, then you got back together with him,
and now we're kind of back together, and for the first time that I've known him, he hit me.
Mm. He hit you?
Yeah.
Is he doing drugs now?
No.
He was sober when he hit you?
Yeah.
He doesn't drink?
He drinks, but he wasn't drinking the night that he was with me.
And he doesn't smoke pot?
Occasionally.
Okay. His addiction is active. So I don't know how you can even talk about him as being through with drugs, because that is active right now.
I guess when I can say...
Look, Leslie, look, he's using drugs. Yeah. He's an addict going again with drugs. And his behavior, sort of all bets are off. When his disease is active, he's going to do all kinds of things. Violence is one of the things that addicts manifest very commonly.
Yeah.
Sounds like your parents were right. He's never had any sobriety. His program is weak, and he's getting back into his drugs. If he wants to stay with you, you need to go to Al-Anon. He needs to have an active relationship with a sponsor and be working the steps, and that's it.
Hold on. Maybe she had it coming. Leslie?
Yes?
What'd you do? He hit you in the face?
He hit me in the head.
Like
behind the head. He didn't hit me to where it was like something that could be shown.
With a closed hand or open hand?
Open.
Is your dad an alcoholic?
No.
Mom?
No.
Well,
why are you so defensive, and why are you such denial about this guy's drug use?
I don't know. I think that I kind of given him the benefit of the doubt because I know the person he can be.
All right. Why are you in such massive denial about who he actually is?
I don't know.
All right. Well, that's it. He's got to get sober. And there's no excuse for hitting a woman, although, you know, with an open hand on the back of the head. I mean, you know, you got
to
do it.
If you want to help him, if you want to help him, you start going to Al-Anon.
But the open hand on the back of the head seems like it's like a Three Stooges move, you know.
I mean, I go to counseling right now, but I feel that I'm not very honest with her.
I will be honest. All right, Drew's mic shut off.
There it is. You got to be honest. You got to start going to Al-Anon. You got to get a sponsor.
Okay.
That's it.
Well, that's the show, Drew. My headphones don't work, but so be it.
You start the show. You came in the way you... Go out the way you came in.
That's right, Drew.
Yeah.
It's very good.
Yeah.
We'll clean that up in post.
Please, please. Yeah.
So, until next time.
This is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying, mahalo.
All right, Drew, seriously.
Yeah, go. Seriously.
I know. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, are you a real doctor? You're just a love doctor.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.